And so the all-powerful Top of the Pops trundled on down the middle of the road. With its massive success, the show didn't hunger for change, but Britain's teenagers definitely did.
From the Sex Pistols, their new one, it's called Pretty Vacant.
Having had a glimpse of one of their bands on Top of the Pops in 1977, the kids were hungry for more, and gradually Top of the Pops began to allow the new young upstarts through their doors. A generation of new young bands were now in the charts and arrived armed with guitar, bass and drums, albeit not plugged in.
You know, 1978 was this kind of collision of different cultures, and quite clearly the powers that be at Top of the Pops were not massively comfortable with, you know, new wave. Suddenly, they were shoehorning all these things that didn't fit. So you did have the Undertones or the Buzzcocks alongside Darts and Boney M.
I was 16, I wanted things that were kind of angry and sort of against the system and counter the boring conformity that was around us. Anybody that seemed to fit that bill, I was a complete sucker for. The kind of bands I've been about, The Enemy, Tweak, People Like Blondie, The Buzzcocks, The Boomtown Rats, Elvis Costello, they were suddenly there. It actually felt like a little blow, like you'd beaten somebody, beating the system, but you got one of yours in there.
Punk had barely featured for the best part of 2 years, but by 1978, it seemed everyone was on Top of the Pops.
Here's a group now who are going to sing all about the best pop show on television. Top of the Pops from Rosillo.
Hold tight.
Sort of slags off Top of the Pops, but at the same time you're on it. We were idealistic and we were enthusiastic about being on Top of the Pops, but aware that we were criticising at the same time.
It's very flattering always to be sent up and mimicked and have the mickey taken out of you. Shows how important you are in some strange way.
Not every true punk band was desperate to mime on Top of the Pops. Some wanted to be heard on their own terms.
Politicians dealing, oh, in 10 years we'll build a flat stand. And it's just too long, and young people just feel, oh, they can't get into it.
So what do you think young people are going to do in years to come?
Get old.
You either played the game or you didn't. I mean, The Clash didn't. They were one band that took a stand and said, no, we're not going to do it.
They said it was phony and inauthentic to mime.
It was pretty much something you had to kind of buy into. And if you were The Clash and you decided that you were not going to go that route, then obviously you were terribly credible, but you had to shift your unit some other way.
You couldn't play live, so The Clash took a stand against the all-powerful Top of the Pops. Now bands were faced with a dilemma, to play or not to play.
They said that they must be the same. What is legal is just what's real. While I'm given to understand.
There was still an element of young groups coming on going, wow, we're on Top of the Pops, you know, playing bouncy records. Against that were the punks that are going, well, we don't want to really be here. Yes, you do.
Shots.
I think given the option of selling close to a million records the day after you appear on Top of the Pops and not selling close to a million records the day after, it was pretty clear to them that they did it or didn't sell any records. You had to do Top of the Pops to sell records.
you're never going to do anything at all ever in life unless you're in it. You know, I mean, the very fact of, like, putting out a record, then you're already joined in with some sort of establishment.
A chance to play on BBC One at 7:30 on a Thursday night to the whole nation, was, who wouldn't do that, really, apart from The Clash?
Nice and sleazy, nice and sleazy, every time.
It became part of your life. It was a mechanism that was part of your life, but TV had such power then, you know, there was no threat from anything else.
If Sham 69 hadn't said, right, we want to go on Top of the Pops to prove that you're not going to sweep us under the carpet, you're not going to destroy us, it's far better going on Top of the Pops. And the little kids say, yeah, I want to watch him, you know, don't you switch it off.
Angels with dirty angels with
there were punk bands happy to storm the Top of the Pop stage. Amongst them, a new voice of the Kids in the Streets.
I don't think Jimmy ever felt he was compromising. Jimmy is a showman, a commercial showman.
We got the blazing, you don't want to go!
Top of the Pops came along and catapulted him into that sort of stratosphere for a while.
'78, I'm on Top of the Pops, and of course it's commercially acceptable, and punk is a part of the way of life now. All I was trying to do was get to the masses. At last, it was actually getting to the people.
You go on Top of the Pops and there's kids from 10, right, to 15, that can't get into gigs can see it.
But once in my life I've got something to say, I want to say it now, but now it's today.
People say, oh, Jimmy, you know, you went on Top of the Pops and you ruined punk. It's absolutely ridiculous to say that, because by doing that, I was able to talk about the kid that was the underdog, the working class kid.
They weren't really outrageous on this show, but they just seemed it. Just the fact they were there. The outsiders coming onto the inside seemed sort of so exciting in itself.
The Skids were young punks whose appearance on Top of the Pops caused division within their ranks.
When we arrived to do Top of the Pops on the day, we knew we had arrived in a foreign country. There was no doubt about it. We just didn't fit in. We didn't understand the way the people were speaking to us. It was the poshest place I've ever been.
61. Four. One.
We nearly split up, is the truth of the matter, based on the arguments of going to do or not to do Top of the Pops. Stuart Adamson, our guitar player, really felt incredibly strongly. His favourite band was The Clash, that they were the leaders on this front. But my two mates were with me that day, which were Steve Jones and Paul Cook from the Sex Pistols. And they were saying, do it, you know, so they were the kind of the other people in my ear that day.
The stalwarts of punk won out and helped force the band's decision to play.
By the time we got to do the performance, that kind of malevolence was spilling out, and it spilled into the performance. Pretty nasty looking, as I remember, on the show. We actually did believe that we had something to say and that was worth saying, and that was important to us, at least. And suddenly, being surrounded by such incredibly life-changing musical acts as the Smurfs and Shawadi Wadi didn't do your conscience much good.
The Skids may have been divided about Top of the Pops, but the vital music press were firmly on the side of The Clash.
Top of the Pops just seemed, particularly, I was an Enemy reader, it seemed to be the Enemy, really. And any band that got on there was mostly kind of, I think, infiltrating.
They say only the strong survive, and from last year's big punk explosion comes a band of Irish survivors, the Boomtown Rats, and She's So modern.
People like the Boomtown Rats were sneered on hugely as being, you know, not plastic punks, I think was the phrase then.
The music press always hated us. They hated us from day one. In fact, famously, there was a journalist who broke ranks and did a long interview with us. And when he went back to the NME office, he was hissed as he went through the offices.
The music press then was so snooty and snobby that, you know, it was a sellout just by doing it.
We, from day one, had decided we want to be the biggest band, the best band in the world. We want to make loads of money. So we had no qualms about that. So we couldn't wait to go on Top of the Pops.
In the wake of punk came New Wave. Bands were less interested in revolution and more keen on making it.
It was one of the ideals that we had. You know, we wanted to break America, we wanted to sell records, and being on Top of the Pops was just one of the pieces on the menu that you had to have. Squeeze were never compromised by doing Top of the Pops like some of the punk bands, you know, they sort of rebelled against doing it. We always enjoyed doing it. It was one of the only ways to get on telly.
Once Squeeze were on the show, they had to do as they were told.
It was a bit like coming back to school. You know, you had to play by the rules. The director sort of barked at you if you didn't do the right thing. Even though everybody kind of knew it was a mimed show, it was the sort of thing my parents would have said, oh, that was great watching you on Top of the Pops. You guys can really play.
Ah, the old Top of the Pops bugbear, miming.
I
love the sound of
breaking glass. I think it was an open secret, the miming thing. I love the sound of its condition. Top of the Pops was not a Jules Holland test of your musicality and your cred, you know, and your ability to play a fantastic lick or demonstrate your amazing voice. It wasn't about that, it was about shifting units.
Flaunting the Top of the Pops rules enabled bands to retain some integrity.
A lot of bands made it really clear that they were kind of taking the piss out of the whole miming thing.
We never pretended that we were doing it live, so we would, I mean, Bob would, like, quite consciously not have the microphone in front of him or be out of sync with the vocal, so his kids knew what he was doing.
What you did get was one of the very few opportunities to see the people you admired physically in the, you know, in the flesh, actually there, and it sort of didn't matter whether they were miming or not.